Blackstone Audio presents China's Long March, 6,000 Miles of Danger by Jean Fritz. This book is read by Bernadette Dunne. To Kuo Ho and Irene Chang. Before the Long March. The Chinese are proud of their Long March, that incredible 6,000-mile year-long epic of escape and survival made by the young Communist Army in 1934 to 1935. Today, museums stand at important points along the route. On school playgrounds, children play at being heroes and heroines as they cross miniature mountains and make-believe rivers, obstacle courses made to represent the path of the march. If you talk to survivors of the march, as I did in the spring of 1986, you will see their faces light up as they recount their memories. For in spite of, and perhaps because of, unspeakable hardships, this year of close comradeship and of shared idealism was a high point in their lives as well as in their revolution. But what brought about a revolution in the first place? Poverty, for one thing. Injustice. Hundreds and hundreds of years of it. Foreigners who came to China and took unfair advantage of the Chinese. And finally, the emperors and empresses who ruled China. They lived in splendor and took little interest in the welfare of the common people. In 1905, a man named Sun Yat-sen, one of the many who knew that China could not go on like this, started an organization dedicated to reform. If only the people could get rid of the imperial system with its emperors and empresses, then they could change China. By 1911, they had raised an army and did manage to overthrow the last imperial dynasty of China. Still, they didn't have enough power or enough money to change China, or even to rule it. So who would rule now? Warlords tried. They conquered pieces of territory and fought other warlords for more territory. Sun Yat-sen tried to strengthen his party, known now as the Nationalist Party, and eventually in 1924, because he couldn't find any other outside help, he accepted the help of Communist Russia, which, having completed a revolution of its own, was eager to spread revolution to other countries. In 1921, however, a small group of Chinese had already formed a Chinese Communist Party. But since their first goal was to unify the country, they were willing to work with the Nationalist Party. The Nationalists, who needed all the help they could get, accepted them. Then in 1925, Sun Yat-sen died, and the following year, General Chiang Kai-shek became the leader of the Nationalists. And gradually it became clear that the Nationalists and the Communists were not getting along. The Nationalists held conservative views about the future of China, talking mainly about unifying the nation and making it independent of foreign domination. But the Communists talked of turning Chinese society upside down, so life would be better for poor people, especially the peasants who made up 80% of the population. More and more, Chiang Kai-shek felt threatened by the growing strength of the Communists, so in 1927, he not only threw them out of the party, along with his Russian advisors, but began executing Communists wherever he could find them. From that time, the Nationalists and the Communists were enemies. This story opens in 1934. By this time, Chiang Kai-shek's nationalist regime was recognized by most foreign countries as the legal government of China, but not by the Communists. In the interior of China, they were building up their army and spreading their revolution among the peasants. They were still determined to make over China. The scene is Jiangxi, a remote mountainous province in southern China. The danger is about to begin. Chapter 1. Something was going to happen. The soldiers knew it. The peasants suspected it. Whatever was coming, it was more than just another battle. Ever since 1927, when the first scattered segments of the Communist Army had moved into Jiangxi province, there had been battles. Small skirmishes at first. Then in 1930, the Nationalist Army began forming a circle around the Communists as if they meant to squeeze the life right out of them. Fighting behind concrete blockhouses strung together with barbed wire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.